Good afternoon. It's a great pleasure just to give a few welcoming remarks to this panel. Very, very distinguished guests that have been put together for this discussion. I want to thank the Brookings Institution, along with our Center for Global Economic Governance in the School of International and Public Affairs for hosting this event today. And I just want to say a word about Jan Svenar, who is our director of the Center for Global Economic Governance. I've known Jan for many years now and was part of a project that he led at the University of Michigan to establish an institute for the understanding of countries emerging from communism in the late 80s and into the 90s. And he's a person of great academic distinction, political judgment, and wisdom. So it's wonderful to have him here, part of Colombia. I will let him introduce the people. I think all of us really want to hear how Europe is going to evolve. I would just say that someday I would like to have a job where all you do is say, we will do whatever it takes, and then the whole world relaxes and everything goes on from there. Jan?
Thank you very much, Lee, thank you. We have a protocol that will sit down, so I apologize that I wasn't standing there right now. Let me welcome all of you on behalf of the Center on Global Economic Governance here at Columbia. It's a pleasure to be able to do this event jointly with Kemal Derviş, who is both faculty member here and also deputy president, vice president of Brookings Institution. And we have a wonderful panel that will spend about 10 minutes each member exposing his and her views on where Europe is, where it's heading. We'll have a brief reaction of panelists to each other, and then we'll open up the floor for discussion so everybody will have a opportunity to participate in it. We'll start with Anne Anderson, who, as you know, is the permanent representative to the United Nations from Ireland. She also was a permanent representative to the European Union and was the Irish ambassador to France in the past. She also has worked as vice president of the United Nations Conference on Trade and Development and currently is tasked by the president of the General Assembly with preparations for this year's UN event on the Millennium Development Goals. So she is here both as a Europeanist and a representative of Ireland. So Anne, please go ahead, the floor is yours.
Thank you very much, Jan, and thank you for the kind introduction. It's wonderful to be here in these magnificent surroundings and, of course, a member of such a distinguished panel. Well, I'm going to nail my colors to the mast from the outset. I am a committed European, intellectually and emotionally. Europe has shaped my whole adult life and in a very positive way. At the same time, I don't consider myself any kind of cheerleader for the European project. I see the mistakes, I see the potential pitfalls. So my optimism, my hope, it's more of the sober variety rather than anything more starry-eyed. But I want to make two points in my short 10 minutes here today. And the first is that I genuinely believe that Europe will regain the momentum despite the current political difficulties. And secondly, I think that my own country, Ireland, is going to contribute to that momentum. Now, I actually, before coming here, I just checked the dictionary definition of momentum, as it's sometimes wise to do, to check your words. And momentum, it's the strength or force that you gain from motion or from a series of events. And if you look back at the series of events that brought Europe to where we are, there is one inescapable fact, and that is that the political and the economic are inextricably interwoven. This was obviously true at the origin. If you go back to the early 50s, the question, of course, was profoundly political. How can we prevent Europe going back into the savagery of war? And the answer could hardly have been more unglamorously economic, the creation of the European Coal and Steel Community. And at each stage where there has been a significant leap forward in Europe, you find that same interweaving of the political and the economic. And indeed, the dream of the euro, when Kohl and Mitterrand had it, it was essentially a political response to the changed map of Europe, the end of the Berlin Wall, the reunification of Germany, binding Germany more fully into the European Union. And the same thing was true, another big leap forward in 2004 with the enlargement of the 10 new member states. I was in Brussels at the time. We sang and danced. It was such a joyous occasion. And we weren't really celebrating the enlargement of the single market. What we were celebrating was the fact, as we saw it, that Europe was whole again. Now, I know that there are many critics and commentators, and perhaps some of them on this panel, who will say, yes, yes, that's true as far as an analysis of the past goes, but that in Europe today, that the past is not prologue to the future, that we're seeing a big rupture in Europe, and that we are now mired in not just in a euro crisis, but in a more existential crisis. Now, I actually don't buy that. I'm not discounting the difficulties. They're very real. But I am convinced that there is a political imperative that will continue to drive us forward. Because you've got to look at the big story. And what is the biggest story that's out there today? It is the changing, evolving nature of global power, the redistribution of power. Despite the setbacks and difficulties that they're encountering, the reality is that Asia, Latin America, Africa are on the rise. And for Europe, it's a question of innovating, integrating, or declining. And we in Europe, I think we get it. I know that sometimes from the outside, we look as if we're lost in the trees and we can't find the wood and that we don't have a strategic sense. But we are not devoid of a strategic sense. We actually see the shape of the future and we know that we need to respond to that. Now, of course, as I said, there are huge challenges, and I'm just going to run very quickly through a few of them. First of all, we need to retool institutionally, and we started doing that with the Lisbon Treaty, and that'll have to be further worked through. We have other big issues. For example, we talk so much, and it's true, about the need to connect with our citizens, democratic legitimacy, democratic accountability, very, very real issues. The enlargement problems, the enlargement challenge, I should say, is a better way to put it. And this perennial question about widening and deepening, and maybe we need to be more honest in our responses on that. And there's the question of strengthening the external relationships. And that's, of course, what the excitement about the Transatlantic Free Trade Agreement is about. And, of course, even more than any of those, we have the most urgent question of what we're going to do about the euro and the euro crisis. And I'm absolutely ready to accept that there were missteps and that there was misdiagnosis. But I think it's fair to say that we are now developing a truly comprehensive response. The European Central Bank is fully stepping up to the plate. The European Stability Mechanism, it's the biggest financial firewall in the world. The steps that are being contemplated towards banking union are truly, truly important. And yes, of course, there's the competitive challenge and we need to do more than give lip service to the Europe 2020 agenda. All that is there. There are huge challenges, but in my view, we're up for it. Now, I want to just spend a few minutes on Ireland, as you'd expect from the Irish ambassador. And I think you all know the arc and the narrative for Ireland. The years of the great years of the Celtic Tiger, the phenomenal growth, the property bubble, the banking crisis that became a sovereign debt crisis, the bailout, the austerity, and now, thankfully, the glimmer of recovery. And I don't want for a moment to underestimate the difficulty and the hurt in Ireland. It's very, very real. But at the same time, the trend is positive. We have got our competitiveness back in a really significant way. The competitive costs are down. Our exports are doing very well. Foreign investment is doing exceptionally well. We are back in growth. It's very, very modest, but it's real. It's growth. And we expect to be fully back in the markets, in the bond market, in the course of this year. So much so even that you sometimes hear the phrases about Ireland that we're the poster child for European recovery or that we're the model pupil. Let me tell you that most of us in Ireland really don't like those descriptions, even if they capture the positive trend. Firstly, they underestimate the degree of hurt that there is in Ireland. And secondly, they're patronizing. I mean, Europe is a club of grown-ups. The problems are grown-up problems, and the solutions are going to be grown-up solutions. And in finding those grown-up solutions, there's going to be two ways forward. One is accepting national responsibility, as we have done in Ireland, through all of those austerity measures that will be familiar to you from headlines and that we feel only too deeply. Second aspect of it is European solidarity. After all, solidarity is what Europe is about, but there is an even more particular onus for solidarity in this case, because if the Irish banks borrowed heedlessly and fecklessly, perhaps, or some of them did, then there were banks who loaned to them who were equally heedless in their loaning. And the fact that the Irish government behaved so responsibly in its response to taking on the bank debt on the shoulders of the Irish taxpayer, had we not behaved so responsibly, the repercussions would have been enormous all over Europe. So I think it was Reagan who said, we took one for the team. And we feel we did take one for the team. So that's going to be, as we see it, the way forward, an accommodation between taking national responsibility, facing up to it, and at the same time, assertively making the claim for European solidarity. And we're not going to shirk from the national response, but we're not going to be shy about continuing to ask for the solidarity. And we believe we're getting it through the kind of steps taken at European level that I've outlined, and also many of you will have seen maybe the deal on promissory notes for Anglo-Irish Bank that came through a couple of weeks ago and is contributing to the optimism in Ireland. And I want to finish on this where I started. I talked about the big picture. And you have to look at the big picture for Ireland as well, because the big picture is whatever, and they're significant, our current difficulties, we would be incomparably worse off outside the European Union. And we are so much better off today than we were, let's say, back in the 80s. So that's my final thing. You have to, if you want to map where Europe is going, you've got to keep your eyes on the big picture. It's an old and resilient continent, and we're a very proud and resilient country. We're coming through, and we are going to regain momentum. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much for a realistic and optimistic assessment. That's very good. A brief commercial in between. I did not at the beginning say something which is obvious, and I should stress that this event would not be possible without the cooperation of a major partner of ours, which is the World Leaders Forum here at Columbia University. They are so terrific and wonderful that I almost forgot to acknowledge them. So I apologize right here and right now. And our next speaker is George Soros, who, if there is a Renaissance man on Earth these days, it's him. He's philosopher, economist, financier, philanthropist, probably best known for having started the Open Society Foundations. I had the privilege to work with him in the early 1990s in Europe when he single-handedly started a brand new university, Central European University, which had a branch in Prague, in Budapest, and in Warsaw, and is now located in Budapest. George has done many things. Probably the most notable right now is that he's launching a new initiative, the Open Society Initiative for Europe, which is launched this year in order to promote alternative views of an open society in Europe and to protect freedoms and liberties on that continent. George, the floor is yours.
Thank you, thank you. Well, when I look at the panel, we are all committed pro-Europeans, so we are in that sense biased. But I happen to disagree with your optimism. I'm afraid that the European Union is in an existential crisis. The problems of the euro have already transformed the European Union from what it was originally conceived into something radically different, because it was meant to be a voluntary association of equals. And today it is difficult to escape from obligation where the debtor countries are subordinated to the dictates of the creditor countries, and have effectively been relegated to second class membership. And I think that this is politically not acceptable. I think that to understand the euro crisis, it's important to realize that it's extremely complex. As you have said, the political and the financial are separate aspects, but they are intertwined. And the financial problems break down into a sovereign debt problem, a banking problem, a balance of payments problem within the EU, and of course a competitiveness divergence competitiveness. And because of the complexity, it's really the course of events has been very largely influenced by misconceptions, misunderstandings, and a sheer lack of understanding of this complexity. The Maastricht Treaty was a very flawed design. The architects of the euro knew that it was incomplete because it created a currency union without a political union. Although at the time they had reason to believe that when the time comes, there will be another step forward which will take take you closer to a political union, because that's really how the European Union was constructed, taking small steps, setting a particular objective, a timetable, gathering the political will, knowing that it will be incomplete, that step will require a further step forward. And that's how it was built, how the EU was built from the coal and steel community to the union. But the euro had several other deficiencies of which the architects were not aware. For instance, it assumed that imbalances would only come from the public sector, because the markets were supposed to correct their own excesses. But actually, the euro problem really came from the private sector, the banking sector. But that's not the most serious. The most serious deficiency is that the member countries, by transferring their seigniorage rights to the European central banks, were actually indebted in a foreign currency, which they did not control. And that raised the prospect of a default. Because normally, a developed a country would never default on its debt because it could print money. But the members couldn't do that. And that is where, the central problem lies. Because this defect was not recognized either by the authorities or the financial markets. When the euro was introduced, it was assumed that the government bonds are riskless, and the banking authorities didn't require banks, commercial banks, to hold any reserves against the risk. And the European Central Bank accepted all the government bonds on equal terms at its discount window. And this created a perverse incentive for the commercial banks to buy up the government bonds exactly of the weaker countries, which were at the beginning selling, offering a high yield because of the risk premium than the others. And their buying resulted in eliminating that risk premium so that it was reduced to practically nothing. And the banks got loaded up with the debt of the weaker countries. Then came the financial crisis of 2007-08. The banks, the markets didn't particularly react. It was only when Greece, the Papandreou government, announced that the previous government had misstated the deficit, and it was much larger than it was expected. That's when the markets suddenly woke up to the possibility that that Greece may default, and then they raised the risk premium not only on Greek bonds but on all the weaker countries with a vengeance, and that created both a sovereign debt crisis and also a banking crisis because the banks were so heavily loaded with those debts. So then a number of other mistakes were made, but the result has been that we've gone from crisis to crisis. And Germany did the minimum that was necessary to preserve the euro, but no more. And that is what maintained the crisis conditions, which are now four years old. There has been recently a great sense of relief in the financial markets because after the fiasco of the June summit and when the risk premiums went to new highs on Spanish and Italian bonds, and it looked like the euro is going to collapse. As a last resort, Chancellor Merkel turned to the president of the European Central Bank, Mario Draghi, and backed him against the president of the Bundesbank. Draghi, who understands markets, did what was necessary, declared the ECB will do whatever it takes to preserve the euro, and introduce some measures the open market, OMT, I think it's called, which actually did the job without actually being implemented. And that's what gave the sense of relief. But I think that's only temporary, because the underlying problems have not been resolved. And they are basically two kinds. One is a political problem, that that Germany is in the driver's seat. Germany doesn't dictate policy, but effectively no policy, European policy, can be proposed without first gaining the approval of Germany. So that's the political issue. But the more serious one in many ways is the fact that Germany is imposing the wrong policy on Europe, because it imposes austerity. The idea is that you have to shrink the deficit in order to shrink your debt. But the debt is a ratio of the accumulated debt to the GDP. And if you reduce the budget, you also reduce the GDP. And in the conditions which currently prevail of insufficient demand, the so-called fiscal multiplier is more than one. That is to say, you reduce the budget deficit by 1 euro, your GDP falls by more than 1 euro. And so you are pushed into this long-lasting recession, during which the debt burden actually keeps going up. And the political pressure is tremendous. You can see it in today's Italian elections, although I think the outcome of that election will actually be the best of the bad situation. You'll probably get a coalition between the central left and Monti, which is the best outcome you can expect from this. So I think this will pass, but I think the situation is going to continue to deteriorate, I think perhaps. I expect that perhaps after the German elections, there will be a change in German attitudes, because by that time, the current policies will begin to have a negative effect on Germany also. Because Europe is today an outlier in maintaining this orthodox financial policy. All the other countries are now, major countries, are engaged in quantitative easing. Japan is the latest convert. And quantitative easing is, in a way, another way of indirect currency devaluation, and the decline in the yen and in the sterling is actually going to affect German exports. So by the time of the elections, I think Germany will also be in a recession, and then I hope that there will be a change, and maybe then your optimism will be more justified.
Thank you. Thank you very much. So thank you for the grand picture and then the specific critical and as well as the positive optimistic remarks at the end. Our next speaker is Kemal Derviş, who, as I mentioned, is the Vice President for Global Economics and Development at the Brookings Institution. He's also a member of the Executive Committee of the Istanbul Policy Center at Sabanci University, was the head of United Nations Development Program and member of the Turkish Parliament. Probably best known among the economists is that he was the Minister for Economic Affairs and the Treasury, responsible for Turkish recovery from the devastating financial crisis of 2002. I frankly think his greatest challenge was when he tried to teach me economics at Princeton, but that's another matter. We're pleased to have him as an adjunct professor at SIPA. Kemal, the floor is yours.
Thank you very much. It's great to be here, and I also very strongly value my association with the university and enjoy teaching here in the fall. Last year, about this time, most American economists, from the conservative side, from the liberal side, predicted that Greece would exit the euro. Many predicted more than that, that other countries would exit and the euro would kind of collapse. And it's not that Draghi helped, of course, and George Soros explained very clearly why Draghi's actions were so important. But otherwise, one cannot see fantastic success in Europe, and we'll come back to that, because the social suffering is terrible in the southern countries particularly. But, you know, even in some of the countries such as France, the situation is very difficult. But I do fully agree with Ambassador Anderson that if one looks at it purely from an economic and financial angle, one misses a good half of the whole dynamic, which is political. Europe is a great political project, an incredibly successful political project, creating a zone of peace in a continent that not only tore itself apart, but the world with it. And I think there is tremendous and justified resistance against anything that deeply threatens that project. I hope George Papandreou, Prime Minister George Papandreou, will talk a little bit about feelings in Greece, but I think even at the worst of the crisis, and even people who are quite on the extreme left, or maybe even those on the extreme right, but very few Greeks contemplate Greece outside the Eurozone, let alone outside Europe. And I think I'll come back to that distinction, very crucial distinction, between the Eurozone and the European Union. So that's the first point I wanted. Let's not underestimate the political resolve most Europeans have to go forward with the European project. However, I do agree that despite Mario Draghi's masterful kind of conduct of the central bank communication, ECB's communication, and the very important, of course, power a central bank has once it decides to use it, to say, believe me, it will be enough. He has kind of countered the markets in some ways. But the essential problem itself has not been resolved. As you know, unemployment in the Eurozone is now close to 12%. In Greece and Spain, it's over 25%. Youth unemployment in many countries is between 30 and 50%. The social suffering is terrible. And I think it's a kind of reflection on the world we live in that financial markets can celebrate, while vulnerable people can suffer as much as they do in large parts of Europe today. So I don't believe at all that the problem is solved. Just two things to note in that context. Since Keynes, many economists have always argued that when there is an imbalance, both the deficit countries and the surplus countries have to contribute to solve that imbalance, putting the whole burden on the deficit countries maximizes the cost, and it would be so much easier if the surplus countries helped. And just two or three numbers here, particularly in the US and among many of us, we were always worried about the Chinese current account surplus, the Chinese exporting their, making recovery more difficult in a place like the US or elsewhere in the world because they accumulate this huge current account surplus. The Chinese current account surplus reached its maximum in 2007 with $411 billion. Today it is about 210, so it went down a lot. And these are absolute numbers, not percentages of GDP. China is not today the country in the world with the largest current account surplus. The country in the world with the largest current account surplus is Germany. Moreover, if you aggregate Northern Europe, both the Eurozone countries and the Scandinavian countries, into one geographical group, it's not a group where that generates normal statistics, because part of them are in the Eurozone, part of them aren't. But the surplus of these Northern European countries is bigger than $500 billion. Okay, so I think this is one issue that will have to be addressed. As long as the Northern Europeans don't pursue a more expansionary policy at home and don't reduce their own surplus, although it's not, the surplus is not at this point in majority with Southern Europe, but it is a surplus in terms of the overall world economy. It is an imbalance, a very serious imbalance. And it is a surplus that's much larger, in fact, 2.5 times larger than China's. So one wonders sometimes why we always discuss China, whereas we don't mention Northern Europe as a source of a global imbalance. So these things will have to be solved. And I think over the next two, three years, this whole crisis will be far from finished, but Europe will struggle to solve it. I do believe that there is, at the end of the day, the political will to do it. And I do also believe that after the German elections, which are in September, you may find a new willingness, a new dynamic, because the election is such an important point there, as in all democracies. And after the election, it may be possible to get more action. Now, when I say more action, again, we don't have time for details, but the Eurozone has to integrate much more. You cannot run in the long run, and I think events have proven it over the last four or five years, you cannot have a common currency without much stronger integration of overall economic policy, fiscal policy, budgetary policy, banking regulation. The banking union has in principle been decided on. So there is this need, if one really wants to overcome the crisis, to integrate the Eurozone much more. There's also the need, and I agree there very much with George Soros, that the macroeconomic policy has to change. The degree of austerity is counterproductive. There is need for structural reforms, of course, also, and there is need for supply-side measures in the southern countries, and Ireland has done some of these. The south also needs to do it. But the balance in terms of the macroeconomic policy is wrong. But that's not enough. To prevent further crises, you need that integration. And one can understand that Germany says, if we're going to commit to the banking union and to saving banks in other parts of Europe, we must have a say in how these banks are going to be supervised. There has to be a degree of sovereignty sharing in the Eurozone that is considerably more than what existed in the past or exists today. And that poses a problem to the European Union. The Swedish Minister of Finance, Anders Borg, declared to the Financial Times 5 days ago, contrary to what David Cameron said in his famous Europe speech, where he said the Eurozone, we don't want to be part of it, but the Eurozone has to integrate more. The Swedish minister said, if the Eurozone integrates more from the point of view of economic policy, it's the end of the European Union. So you do have the Eurozone with the need to integrate, with, I think, a political dynamic that will lead to it. But then you have other countries, foremost, of course, the United Kingdom, but also others, Sweden. Norway is not part of the Union, but it's very close and would not want to integrate the European Union, who don't want to be part of the Eurozone and don't want to have that degree of sovereignty sharing. So I think we're facing a real challenge here for the European Union as a whole. What will happen? Again, we can't go into the details, but my proposal, my thought, is that what needs to happen is that the Eurozone goes forward, but that there are two groups of countries within the larger European Union. The Eurozone, moving towards quasi-federalism, that may be a strong word, but a lot of sovereignty sharing. And then another group of countries, including the United Kingdom, including Sweden, and some others, that will remain part of the single market, that will participate in the common defense and security policy, in the common foreign service, that will share strongly, of course, in scientific cooperation, and of course, the single market means you can live and work anywhere in the European Union as a citizen of the European Union, okay? But that group of countries will not engage in the degree of sovereignty sharing that the Eurozone does. This will require a fundamental restructuring and reinvention of the institutions. You already have the Eurogroup and ECOFIN of finance ministers. You will need to have a European Parliament that meets in a way in two groups. The large European Parliament meeting on the pan-European Union affairs, and then a smaller version, and again, no details, but it has to be thought through for Eurozone affairs, and so on. So I think that is, in my view, part of the solution to kind of having the European Union continue, but also have the Eurozone integrate much more strongly. And then, of course, I can't stop, since after all I'm Turkish, saying that in fact that kind of Europe opens a new opportunity also for Turkey, because while Turkey, I don't think will want to or will be accepted inside the integrated Eurozone, there will be too much sovereignty sharing there, and the size of the country is so considerable that French and German resistance to that will be important and understandable. I mean, I wished it wasn't, but to be realistic. But I think in the second group, with Sweden, with Norway, with some others, and with the United Kingdom, there is a place for the very large European country that Turkey is, that can add dynamism, more rapid growth, a more favorable demographic structure to the whole of Europe. So that's where I'll stop. As I said, after all, I am a Turk.
Thank you, Kemal. Thank you for bringing the political aspects and forecasting the future so clearly in terms of the specific institutions that we need and will have going forward. Our next speaker is Joseph Stiglitz. For many of you, needs no introduction. He's the university professor here, Nobel laureate. I should mention that he's also co-chair of the Committee on Global Thought here at the university, and co-founder, co-president of the Initiative for Policy Dialogue, somebody who's been engaged in the debate about Europe for a long time. So, Joe, the floor is yours.
Okay. Well, thank you. And I suppose, like everybody else, I do think the political project of Europe was well-intended. And I agree with Kemal that they're largely a political issue, and I'm going to come back to that. But I'm going to spend most of my time talking about the economics. And economics is the dismal science, and this is Europe is giving us really a field day for depression, because Europe is in a recession, and many countries in Europe are in depression, and we should be aware of that. If you look at where the GDP is, the declining GDP in Italy, which is not one of the crisis countries, is as deep as in the Great Depression. Kemal made reference to the fact that unemployment, youth unemployment in, Greece or Spain is over 50%. I think George was saying it's over 60% in Greece. There is an enormous amount of destruction of human capital going on. And what this portends for the future of Europe, I think, is not positive. What is even worse is, while I've enjoyed the previous discussions, I don't really share the optimism that they have. And I certainly, when I go to Spain and the other crisis countries, I don't see anybody there seeing any hope of getting out of the current problem unless there are some dramatic changes in policy at the European level. And maybe the crisis will eventually motivate those, and I'll come back to that at the end. But one should understand that this crisis, this disaster, is man-made. It's totally man-made. It's not like they had a tsunami. It's not like they had any natural disaster. This is a man-made disaster. And basically, the man-made disaster has four letters, the euro. The euro is what brought this problem on. The euro project is a great project. But when they went from a political project that had trade, that had an attempt to integrate, create a single market, to create a single currency, before the political framework was created, that was what invited the disaster that followed. So the question is, can Europe work? The answer is yes, but there needs to be a lot deeper economic reforms than has been talked about so far. And so my view is, and I'll try to explain it, is that the fundamental, what is fundamentally needed is structural reform, but not structural reform within the European countries, structural reform of Europe and of the euro framework. Now, the underlying problem, George already basically gave the elements of the underlying problem. The economics jargon says that Europe was not an optimal currency area. It was not a group of countries that could easily share the same currency. It was right that the European political leaders understood that, but they knew that they needed to do more. But the politics which was driving the euro, there was not enough solidarity to create the political institutions that would, that might make the euro work. And the hope was that sometime down the line, those would be created. And now we've had, since the crisis began in Greece in 2010, we're into our, now into the fourth year, and we haven't seen that, even in the faces of the crisis, we haven't seen the development of those. We've seen movements in the right direction, but clearly not enough. And this, I agree very strongly with George, not enough. So it was based on the hope that these institutions would evolve. When there was no crisis, it didn't happen at all. And now that the crisis, it's begun to happen, but very slowly. Part of the problem was before, as the euro was being created, there was a misdiagnosis, a failed analysis of what was going to be needed to make this diverse group of countries work. The idea was if they realized they had to converge, they developed what they called the convergence criteria. And what they said is, and they focused on too little, that the countries could not have too much debt, could not have too big a deficit, 3% deficit, 60% debt. That may have been necessary, but it was clearly not sufficient. And then they continue to look at that as the core framework when it clearly isn't the problem. Ireland and Spain had a surplus before the crisis, had low debt GDP ratios before the crisis, and yet they are among the crisis countries. And the problem is that Germany keeps talking about Greece, which did have a deficit, and ignoring the totally different situation in Spain and Ireland and the other crisis countries. So when you have a misconception at the beginning and a failed misdiagnosis as time goes on, not a surprise that things have not worked out very well. And continually, as what they say is, we have to have stronger enforcement, more austerity. Austerity is part of the problem. It's part of the reason that Europe is in recession now. It's not the solution. It's part of the problem. And this failed mindset is really inherent part of the difficulty. So let me try to describe what I think what is needed. And here, let me begin by agreeing with Kemal. It's very clear what is needed is more integration. There either has to be, in my mind, more Europe or less Europe. It can't go in the current halfway house. And more integration is going to require more, we sometimes call it more of a fiscal union, can take the form of euro bonds or ECB borrowing. And again, let me just say, George's diagnosis was absolutely right. What they did when they created the euro is they left countries to borrow in a currency that they don't control. And that put them in the position of a developing country. And we've had developing country crisis after crisis, and that's what they've done. Now, they can solve that problem by having the ECB borrow, or they can solve the problem and lending on then to the country. So they can solve the problem by having Eurobonds. But so far, Germany has said over and over again it will not tolerate a Eurobond. So far, I see no glimmer of the kind of solidarity that would make this work. Secondly, they need a banking union. The reason for this should be obvious. Exacerbating the problem of austerity is that with a single market, money flows around everywhere very easily, and money's leaving the banking systems of the countries that are in crisis. Backing any country's banks is the government. The credit default swaps of the sovereigns and the credit default swaps of the banks of any country are very highly correlated. So as money leaves the banks can't lend and the country goes further down. So you need a banking union. But when talking about a banking union, they keep focusing so far on common supervision. But what you need is common deposit insurance, common supervision, and common resolution. And they say, yes, we're going to get to those eventually, but so far, very little work on the two other pillars. The third thing they need is, obviously, austerity is not going to bring Europe back to prosperity. They need a growth strategy. There are some ideas that have been floated around, but 2.5 years later, nothing's happened. When the Greek crisis began, the European leaders got together and they said they recognized austerity wasn't going to work. They said they're going to have a growth strategy. Nothing's happened, essentially, for 2 years. The fourth thing they need is for a common current with countries as divergent, you have to have some policies to enable the countries that are below to catch up. And that means you need industrial policies. But the competitiveness criteria of Europe prohibits the use of those industrial policies, condemning effectively those behind making it difficult to catch up. Finally, I want to agree very strongly with Kemal. You need adjustment inside Germany, wage increases, internal devaluation, which is the strategy that Germany is recommending, forcing the burden on other countries, has never worked. If internal devaluation would have worked, the gold standard would never have been a problem. The gold standard didn't work. It was part of the factor leading to the Great Depression. So why they continue to insist on internal devaluation, putting the burden of adjustment on all the other countries, seems to me very, very foolish. So let me just conclude very quickly. The euro was intended to bring the countries of Europe together. It was a political project. But in fact, what it is doing has been to divide Europe. And the tensions are very, very clearly there. It's been described by the other speakers. There is, right now, as I see it, insufficient solidarity to make it work. When I hear, every time I go to Germany, over and over again, the notion, we are not a transfer union, that is a statement is, we do not have adequate solidarity to make the euro work. So in my mind, to save Europe, to save the European Union, it may be necessary to sacrifice the euro. So I hope that isn't true. I hope that there are the political reforms that will reinvigorate the solidarity in Europe. And I hope that they happen fast enough, because while I am convinced about the political leaders being committed, the question is the time frame that is in their mind consonant with the time frame of markets?
Okay, thank you. Thank you very much, Joe, for the precise description of the problem and the outline of the steps. Our next speaker is George Papandreou. Again, no need to introduce him for many of you here at Columbia. He was the Prime Minister of Greece from 2009 to 2011, member of the Parliament since 1981, is known for his commitment to promoting peace and democracy. He was very successful as foreign minister, engineering rapprochement between Turkey and Greece, and is the prime minister who implemented the austerity measures, which then set off the big discussion and future development. We're very pleased to have him here as an adjunct professor with us. And George, tell us where we are and where we're heading.
Well, thank you very much. It's a pleasure to be here, and it's great to be able to be with such a wonderful group of students in my class discussing these issues. So it's something I've been enjoying. But I'd like to bring my sort of personal view, a little bit of how things unfolded and where we're going, agreeing with a lot of what I've heard. When I was elected on a mandate, certainly not of austerity, but of change. That was the mandate. Actually, was a mandate, a slogan, which was either we change or we sink, which rhymes in Greek. So we knew that we really needed deep reform. In the end, of course, my first priority became, because of the situation, after revealing that our deficit was not 6% as the previous government had misstated, but 15.6%, that I had to do everything I could to keep the country from bankruptcy and exiting the euro, which with a lot of political costs, but people say, well, you were pretty unlucky. I said, well, I would look at it differently. I'm glad that I was able to be in this so important position at my country's most dire moment. But what I do also believe is that Europe could have done a lot more, as others have said. And this, of course, was my position very much from the beginning when the crisis developed. And I remember talking to many of the friends on this panel and others also about the Greek crisis, and many were saying, well, this is not a Greek crisis, but it's a crisis which is showing the cracks or the inefficiencies or the difficulties of this Eurozone project. And I, of course, as the ambassador here and others have said, very pro-European, an avid pro-European, I would say, but I would say it's slightly different. I would say, yes, we can, but we haven't yet. We have a lot more to do. And I would also say that we underestimate the capabilities of what the European Union can do together, collectively. I would say, as George Soros said, that there was a lot of misunderstandings, and I'll just mention very quickly three myths about this. First of all, the first myth was this was a Greek problem. So therefore, the whole burden of the solution, of course, would be on Greece. And there was a very strong narrative. It still exists. This is lazy Greeks, the ouzo drinking, Zorba dancing Greeks. This is the problem. I said, well, that would be easy to solve if we could change our drink and change our dance. But in fact, I looked up in OECD statistics, and Greeks work hardest amongst all European Union, compared to all European Union countries. That was not the problem. There were other problems. But however, that narrative was part of this. And of course, it then extended to the south, the profligate south. As you said, Joe, Spain did not have a deficit. It was a surplus country. It was within the Maastricht Treaty. So this was certainly, first of all, a wrong diagnosis on that. Then the second diagnosis was after a year, the Troika, the so-called Troika, which is the IMF, the ECB, and the Commission, realized that we would not be able to access the markets in 2012, which was, of course, the programmed time. Now, if Greece is the problem, then Greece, again, is the problem there. So everybody said, you didn't do reforms, you didn't make changes, and so on. Well, so that was another myth. I say it's a myth because again, the OECD in 2012 proclaimed that Greece was the number one reformer amongst all OECD countries. We had reduced our deficit by 6.5%, which was a record for any Eurozone country. We had taken many measures, like next year will be, or this year will be, with a primary surplus, tax reforms, consolidation of regional governments, pension change, opening up 150 professions. I put everything online to fight corruption, every expenditure, and many more things, fighting tax evasion and so on. So I would say that there are issues which have been mentioned here which are need to be seen. First of all, which are not particularly Greek. I don't say we didn't have our problems, but I always said we had our first responsibility to change our country and reform our country. But the Eurozone structures, the lack of oversight by the Commission itself, the ECB and its single-mindedness around inflation and not employment, imbalances which were mentioned, Kemal, you mentioned the surplus and deficit economies, the fact that the lack of competitiveness with other parts of the world, and we didn't have much of a growth policy and haven't had a growth policy, wider financial imbalances such as tax havens, which have made it very difficult for us in Greece to collect taxes, not only an internal question. We have to work together now to see what tax havens do around the world. The banking sector, after the Wall Street debacle, not investing in the real economy, and of course we haven't yet dealt with this problem sufficiently, and you mentioned the banking union. The great insecurity that was created, and particularly in Greece, this consistent talk about Grexit, exit of Greece, meant that nobody was investing, nobody was buying, nobody was consuming, nobody was lending, nobody was borrowing. So we had a multiplying effect of sort of a paucity of any economic development or activity. A final myth is austerity versus reform. I'll just read what Martin Wolf said yesterday in the Financial Times. He said, austerity and reform are the opposite of each other. If you are serious about structural reform, it will cost you upfront money. Now, he was talking about the Eurozone and the austerity programs. And now, more money, of course, would mean more time, would mean more money for reforms. And we created a mechanism, very important, of course, the EFSF or the ESM. But this is basically based on loans from member states to this mechanism to give loans then to the countries needed in the adjustment programs. If we really wanted to give time and do this at a pace which is much more humane and I would say more effective politically, we would need something, as I said before, like a Eurobond, where we could go out on the markets and the markets would accept this. And this, I think, is another major flaw. Is we allow the market fears to push us around and to dominate the whole political and economic debate. Now, I would say that, of course, there's a bittersweet outlook around Europe. There's the good and the bad. First of all, if we look at Europe, the bad side, the bitter side, is that GDP results are quite dismal. There is no really long-term growth strategy. We're not pooling our strengths the fear of pooling our risks, and I think we've already pooled our risks. I say this very often to my German counterparts. We've already pooled our risks, and now is the time to pool our strengths. And we would be able to calm the markets and do so in a better way. One of the ideas, of course, is in fact the importance of this banking union. We have strong centrifugal forces, and we're still in a volatile situation. You know, we're looking at, well, what will happen with the Italian elections? What happens with these recent developments in Spain? Could this tip the cart? And of course, youth unemployment. That is a time bomb, I believe, for Europe, not only for Greece, but for Europe itself. The positive is that the Rubinis of the world underestimated the political will of the Europeans to stick together. The whatever it takes from Draghi was positive and did calm the markets, even though it hasn't solved this, but it did show that if you intervene in the right way, you can be effective. We are creating institutions with better oversight, so the European Stability Mechanism also, and the Banking Union. We have moved towards the financial transaction tax, which I think is positive from a number of reasons. First of all, bringing in new revenues, but secondly, also fighting some of the speculation that, in the banking sector. And of course, Ireland is showing signs of recovery. Portugal, maybe less so, but with more pain, but still is moving forward. In Greece, I think the negative side is we have 20% contraction in GDP over these last years since 2008, 6% contraction the last quarter. We have extremes in the political spectrum trying to scapegoat, unluckily scapegoating migrants, terrible phenomenon, and I'd like to thank George Soros publicly for his involvement in trying to fight this racism around Europe, but also in Greece. And this, of course, does not allow for the government to focus on the real issue of reform and is basically focusing on austerity. We need to move on reform. The positive is that, you know, Greeks are a proud people. We're taking the pain. We have recovered 50% of our competitiveness. We've improved dramatically concerning our current accounts balance, 40%. The whole discussion about a Grexit, I think, is subsiding. Tourism is up, and you are all welcome, of course. But finally, I just want to basically confer and agree with what I heard earlier. We need the political discourse. I think we need to get away from, and those who are Europeans here know this, a discourse which has become quite racist and quite scapegoating, whether it's the south towards the north or the north towards the south. That's undermining the basic principles on which Europe was based. And I think we need to change that discourse. Secondly, we need a growth strategy. And I was very unhappy that the budget, everybody was jubilant about cutting the budget, the European budget. Now, obviously, we have to do this at the consolidated, at the national level. But we could have created a stimulus, and I would say, why not a green stimulus, a competitive stimulus, a quality stimulus for Europe. Third, we need a program for the unemployed. There's a great program called Erasmus for students. I propose, why don't we make that similar, sort of a scholarship for the unemployed where they could be trained anywhere they want in Europe. And that would, of course, would need some money, but it would be much less than the 150 billion, I think it's estimated by the ILO, that it's costing in social costs and economic costs. The fact that we have huge numbers that are neither employed or in education or in training. We need further integration, which in the end means further centralizing our decision making, whether it's in fiscal policy, banking union, economic or social policy. But that also means we need to democratize our European institutions, and therefore we cannot simply hand over to some bureaucracy in Brussels. We need to democratize. So there are all kinds of ideas. Kemal mentioned that I have been a proponent of electing a European president from the European citizens. The European project is an elite project up to now. We need to make it a people's project. Finally, I think we need to rethink this whole austerity program and prioritize deep reform. If we go along this, I think we will be facing new restructurings of our debt. But in any case, let us have a grand bargain where we say, let's support these countries in adjustment for deep reforms to make them truly viable economies, but do it in a way which is much more humane. Thank you very much.
Thank you, George. Thank you for a really detailed account and I think comprehensive picture, as well as the view from Greece. I'll be quick in my presentation since much has been said. My main thesis is that the European Union is likely to survive. I think that the Eurozone also, although with somewhat lower probability, as we saw, it's to a large extent a political project that I think there is a large, a significant determination to accomplish. Europe as a whole is rich, and so it's a question of political will to find the right solution. It's not like people don't know what to do, it's just a question of finding the will. Temporarily, the situation has calmed down, which is very good. It gives an opportunity to carry out some of the reforms. The question is, will they be carried out? And importantly, will growth return? Because right now, the situation is very difficult in the sense that the European Union is stagnant economically and the Eurozone is declining and expected to decline. My worry, principal worry, is that the solution to these problems will take the form of a very gradual approach, muddling through, rather than a quick solution. I think, however, that exit by Greece and others is unlikely. I think that we will have entry of new members into the Eurozone, so there actually is demand on the part of the countries to enter the Eurozone as well as the European Union more broadly. So I think that's the outline. Now, the barriers to the solution are economic, political, and social. The austerity is reaching political and social limits in many of the countries. There is economic nationalism in the sense that the rich core countries are unwilling to pay for what they see as profligacy of the periphery countries. And there is the merciless sort of debt accumulation arithmetic that was mentioned, that as GDP declines, debt over GDP is growing, even if debt itself is not growing. And so the question is what will happen, and what we see in terms of the policymakers in Europe is that very often decisive steps are deferred unless they are really pressed by a crisis-type situation to take some steps. So I think that's really the weakness right here. I mentioned that it's unlikely that we will have exit from the Eurozone, and that was nicely, I think, demonstrated by the case of Greece here. I think that with the case of United Kingdom, we may face the possibility of an exit from the European Union, and that, I think, will be a big issue that would be forthcoming in the next couple of years and will create all sorts of problems that I think countries are not yet ready to deal with. I think the big issue here that was already outlined is the German issue, that Germany, in a way, is less willing to subsidize other countries. And I think that it's in part because World War II and even Cold War are becoming more of a history. And there is strong preference for imposing austerity rather than taking the other steps that have been outlined here. So until that is resolved, I think that we will have this indecisive kind of muddling through period going forward. In terms of the future development, I think it's important to realize that Europe has incredible potential. It's a continent which is the largest economy in the world. Because there are still quite a few inefficiencies, by eliminating those, Europe can really move ahead, so it has considerable potential. The problem is the upfront austerity that's facing many of these countries, that basically the remedy that has been taken is one that is creating many of the problems, as has been discussed. So I think the threats are the instability related to weak GDP, and steps like the downgrade of the UK economy, for instance, can add to the uncertainty and the instability. And should there be slowdown in the United States or in the world economy, that would have further unfortunate repercussions on Europe. So let me stop here. And I'll give a chance to the panelists to react to each other briefly, and then we'll have questions and answers. Anybody?
Let me just make maybe perhaps one point, which is an additional hope. I was in Europe just the last 3 days, and the European Parliament has not accepted the budget negotiated and agreed by the Council. And what's interesting is not just the Left and the Greens, but even the Christian Democrats and the Europe's People Party, you know, the right of center part of the European Parliament, is so far saying we're not going to accept this budget. And I think that's an assertion of the Parliament. George Papandreou said, I think that's very true, that integration does not just mean technocratic decisions on banking union and more, you know, more integrated technocracy in Brussels. It really means more European political space and democracy, and the Parliament has to be at the center of that. Now, whether a certain phone call from a certain lady to some parliamentarians will in the end force the center-right to endorse the budget, I don't know. But the fact that this is a real challenge, I think, is important. And I honestly hope that the European Parliament will reject the budget agreed by the Council.
Okay, Anne.
There's been a lot of negative comment from the platform here, a critical comment about the euro, the design of the euro and the future of the euro. And I just want to say, everybody recognizes that there were design flaws in the euro. That's common to all of us. And the very fact that it began as a political dream is itself explanation for some of those design flaws. What happened then was that the euro proceeded more or less on its merry way for about 10 years, and the worries that may have been there on the part of economists at the time of the creation, they grew somewhat quieter. And then, of course, we had the financial collapse, the global collapse affecting everybody in 2008, and that was the shock that exposed the design flaws in the euro. So, belatedly, having been lulled into a decade of relative security, suddenly, with the absolute 2020 vision of hindsight, we now all see with utter clarity what the design flaws were. The question at this point, I think, is not whether or not there were design flaws. We know the answer to that. The question is whether those flaws are fatal flaws and that the project is doomed to collapse because of the inherent flaws, or whether they are rectifiable flaws. Now, I think in listening to the contributions, George Shoras came closest, I think, at one point in his presentation. It seemed almost as if you were saying these actually are fatal design flaws. But I thought as you came to the end and you looked to a possible change in sentiment in Germany following the elections, you came more into the camp that these are rectifiable flaws. Because that's my view, and I think it's the more widely shared view. And yes, of course, we do need more integration, and that has to be part of the answer. That's the lack of logic in the currency. But that's now accepted wisdom in Europe. And it's not really, yes, there has been catch up and all of that, but this idea that it is, we are doomed to continue to muddle through too little, too late, band-aid here, band-aid there, I don't think the facts actually bear that out. When you look at the kind of awakening that there has been in the European institutions and including in Germany to the very, very serious problems. But this project, it is too important to fail. It will not be allowed to fail. There is too much invested in it. And I think there has been an underrating here both of the recognition of the flaws and the willingness to deal with them in a fundamental way. Thank you.
Sure. Certainly,
the flaws are correctable, but unfortunately, there is no political will to do it. Because if we recognize that, let's say, one of the most crucial problems is this risk of default, which was unrecognized, there is a very simple solution. It can be expressed in one word, Eurobonds. Now, it would actually resolve most of the issues because it would remove the sovereign debt problem. It would greatly relieve the banking problem. The only thing would be left the competitiveness issue, which would not be corrected. That could be only corrected if, in fact, the euro broke up into two components, the debtor countries and the creditor countries, and the euro would be given, the ECB would be given to the debtor countries, which would fall in currency, fall in value, and the euro, and then the competitiveness would also be reestablished. But that's a very, of course, it would be very wrenching. And it could be avoided by Germany changing its mind and accepting the liabilities and responsibilities that go with being the dominant power. But Germany didn't seek to be the dominant power and is not willing to accept those liabilities. In fact, the more Chancellor Merkel has made concessions to keep the euro, going, or the more political determination there is not to give any support, any transfer. Transfer union is a dirty word for the European Union, for the Eurozone. So that's where the problem is. And I'm afraid that when you are outlining all these wonderful plans, you know, with the banking union and so on, they are rather, how shall I say, flimsy. And even the promises that Germany subscribed to at a time of crisis when it was considered necessary are gradually being whittled away. So this much heralded banking union is boiling down to very little, because there is not going to be any collective support for banks. It's all going to be remain silos, and the banking system is gradually becoming into national silos. So you are in the middle now of a process of disintegration that needs to be reversed. So I mean, I'm just being realistic that something has to be done to recapture the spirit of solidarity and collective working together that was the original conception.
I don't want to monopolize time, but I feel if I could have a 30-second response on that. I'm not the German ambassador, and but I do feel this kind of collective criticism of Germany for being austerity obsessed, failing to take on its responsibility, and so on. That's not fair. The German people went through a very tough time after unification. They took on themselves very, very tough measures of austerity to make them, as a unified economy, fit for purpose. So it's easy to have some sympathy with their hesitations about a transfer union and euro bonds. Because, as I say, I don't want to monopolize it, I feel, as well as expecting more of Germany, we need to do a certain amount of confidence-building measures for the German government and the German public to demonstrate to them that we, who have all of these national problems, that we're prepared to shoulder our responsibility. And I don't think we're going to get a Germany that closes its eyes, closes its ears, and totally forgets the vocation of Germany, the original vocation of Germany in the European Union. I'm not writing off Germany in that way.
I would just interject, my reading is like yours, except I think there really is also the experience with East German subsidies that's making them very cautious in Germany nowadays, and I think that's part of the reluctance to really engage more. Joe?
Yeah, well, first, I can understand having sympathy and understanding for Germany's position, but that doesn't change the fact that if they don't support the euro bonds, you can understand why they might not, there's going to be a real problem. And there are some other ways of getting around it. You could have the ECB borrow and relend. I mean, there are many institutional ways. But so far, every suggestion about one of the ways that would deal with it has been resisted. So, you know, that's the first concern. Let me, I guess, a couple of very brief remarks. First, one is that while it is true that the flaws were in the Eurozone, the structural flaws, were not fully exposed to most people until after the crisis, it was clear that before the crisis, the consequences of the flaws were there. And those included the money was flowing into these countries. The markets assumed that because you would eliminate exchange rate risk, you would eliminate all risk. And so the bubbles, in some sense, in Spain and other countries, were in part related to the creation of the euro. So you can't separate what happened after the crisis from the flaws that were there that helped create the crisis in the first place. And the ECB didn't do anything about it, nor did the national banks. I mean, let me say, I'm not blaming the ECB because Fed didn't do anything either, but you created a framework with that made it very difficult for national governments to respond. Secondly, I just want to really reinforce what George said, that the focus in the banking union on supervision is not really the key issue for the next for the moment. The real point is money is leaving the country, the banking systems, and unless you have common insurance and common resolution, that will continue. And yes, I understand Germany saying that we don't want to put things into weak banks. You're not going to fix the weakness of the banks in the next 1 or 2 years unless you have massive recapitalization, and the countries can't do it themselves, and so that will have to be from Europe. And so unless there's enough solidarity to recapitalize the banks, that flow of money out of the banking system is going to continue, and that's going to exacerbate the effects of austerity. And the final point is that I think, you know, Papandreou described a set of myths. One of the myths is that the problems are due to the failures of each of the individual countries. And each of the individual countries made mistakes, but the real question is where do the locus of the principal problem, and it's, I think, in the euro construct. So one of the things that helps that is this focus on individual country structural reform. That takes the shift burden away from the eurozone structural reform and puts it on the individual country. Many of the structural reforms that have been talked about actually, in the short run, are having adverse effects because they're decreasing demand and exacerbating the effects of austerity. They may be good in the long run, but in some of them are really taking away the sovereignty of the countries. They are part of exacerbating the democratic deficit in the way that they were imposed on Greece and some of the other countries. So it seems to me that to a large extent, I can't go into it, the structural reform agenda has been a misplaced agenda.
May I just say one thing on follow up on Joe and others, and vis-a-vis Germany, a very favorable point, I think, for Germany. It is the Germans in 2002, 2003, who actually, at the time of Joschka Fischer, with the support of Gerhard Schröder, proposed a much stronger political union in Europe. And it is other Europeans who turned it down. I totally agree with the Eurobond issue, with all the things, but I think one has to accept that the counterpart for that is stronger political union. You cannot have Eurobonds and a joint resolution of banks and intervention and all that without having legitimate Eurozone-wide political institutions that back that up. And I think to the extent that Germany is asking for that sincerely, I think they're right. But again, 2 points. One question to Ambassador Anderson. Would you agree with me that it's unreasonable to accuse the Chinese of having a huge current account surplus and not talking about the German one, when in fact the German one is bigger than the Chinese one? The second point is, the problem in many ways, coming back to what I said a minute before, may well end up, and Jan mentioned it, coming back to the UK. Because how is the Eurozone going to organize its further necessary integration, which we agree, when the Swedish minister says that would destroy the European Union, and when the UK, although David Cameron agreed that it's needed, will stay outside and has done everything, like it did again in the budget, the budget that we just talked about, to kind of weaken the Eurozone. So in a way, I mean, the problem is very complex, but the whole relationship with the UK is going to be a crucial problem that needs to be solved if the Eurozone is to integrate successfully in the next few years.
Now, let me propose that we have obviously more discussion that can be had here, but why don't we now bring in the audience and we can continue this discussion based on the questions. If you would please identify yourself briefly, pose the question as succinctly as possible, mm-hmm. say if it's to a particular member of the panel or the panel as a whole.
Okay. Thank you.
Thank you.
My name is Nicholas Katsimbers. I'm a graduate student studying conflict resolution. We have been hearing about the design flows. It's a reoccurring theme. And the past couple of years, political unity has been increasingly appearing the narrative as is the solution for Europe's future. However, given the strong national identities inside the EU and their direct relation to their national currencies, political unity wasn't in the narrative when the citizens of Europe were deciding to give up their currencies. At the same time, austerity now helps in the transition of sovereignty towards the center. And my question is the following. Could the architects of Europe actually fail to identify the degree of their flaws? How accidental has the faulty Eurozone expansion been since the crisis seems to now be the vehicle to the long-sought integration? Or is this what Margaret Thatcher referred to as a federal union through the back door? Thank you.
Who would like to take it? George Papandreou.
I would say I'm an optimist about Europe myself, but I think one needs to be to highlight the problems, just in fact to make sure that we're moving in the right direction. And I think what you're saying is, if I read you right, is something that I felt at some point, a certain frustration, if you like, that we could have dealt with this crisis much earlier. Since we're talking about Germans, I don't like to talk about sort of a country because there are different policies and different views in different countries. So I'll take another German, Per Steinbrück. He happens to be the candidate for the chancellorship of the Social Democrats. And he said just a few days ago, he said, had the European Union guaranteed Greek bonds in the initial stage of the crisis, when we actually had started reforms, we had started consolidating our budget, very difficult reforms, the crisis would be over. Maybe not over, but it wouldn't have been a contagion and it would have been much more manageable. So what I feel is a frustration is that at some point, I think that some people felt that this was a blessing in disguise, that, you know, let the markets push, let things, you know, really get out of hand, and then we'll get these countries in order. They'll have to put their house in order. Now, we have to put our house in order in certain ways. But what that has done is it's backfired, I think, because the markets now are mistrusting the whole Eurozone, the whole construction of the Eurozone. And it's been pushing Europe to make leaps and bounds, like the banking union and the euro bonds, which I very much in favor, but which politically are much further ahead than what we have been prepared for. While we could have solved this much much more easily with doing less but more quickly. However, when at the point where we're reaching now, we'll have to deal with that question that we have to create a sense of more of a European identity and solidarity, keeping our national identities, but also. Creating more of a sense of a European solidarity, which George Soros mentioned a lot, and others, because otherwise, I would again agree with Joe here, we either move and quite quickly into deeper integration, or I would see there'll be more tensions for splintering.
Okay, we'll take a question from here.
Thanks. Ben Green, I'm a student at SIPA. We talked about the political will to reform and change the euro, but we didn't really talk about what's ostensibly behind that, which is the will of the people or the will of the citizens. And Mr. Papandreou briefly mentioned creating the solidarity, but I'd be interested to hear how do we generate from what's been in the past a very elite-led or top-down project within the EU to create more of a bottom-up resurgence of demand for this reform amongst the people, because I think the pushback has been legitimate in that they've been not involved in the project so far, but how do we generate that involvement?
I think there are two aspects to it. People talk easily, perhaps too easily, about better communication with our citizens, as if somehow if we just kept talking to them more, they would be more converted. to the idea of more Europe. That underestimates, I think, both the problem and the intelligence of our people. It's not to say there isn't a communication gap, but simply communicating better isn't going to be the answer. And I think George Papandreou and a couple of the others talked in their, some of their interventions about some of the steps that are envisaged, that are being discussed. Some were there in the Lisbon Treaty, for example, greater powers for the European Parliament, making the European Parliament much more meaningful than this kind of distant apparatus that it is seen in many European member states. There's a very lively discussion underway about how the election of the President of the European Commission, or the selection, might become a much more democratic process rather than the process it is at present. So, but I think also, and they're all questions that need to be addressed, this whole churning that's occurring in Europe is making people realize that Europe matters in every aspect of their lives. Now, obviously, this is being perceived negatively in some countries, of course, because, and it has suits some national governments, to, as it always has, to scapegoat Brussels in so many ways. We hate that this is happening to us, but it's all the fault of Brussels. But it is a time when people are becoming extraordinarily literate about what's happening in Europe, aware about the day-to-day impact that Europe has on their lives. So I think a combination of the continuing to develop the institutional answers, communicating better, seizing this opportunity of making of building on that awareness that people have about how much Europe matters, to try to channel the discussion. And of course, I mean, I don't have time to go into it all, but it bears very much on the discussion we had earlier about austerity and growth, because people have to, I mean, they're not going to warm to Europe unless they perceive Europe as something at least largely benign, or more benign than the opposite, and more the solution to their problems than the cause of their problems. So it's a complex, multifaceted approach that's required.
Can I just...
Yep, please.
George has been quiet here about this, but... George did something that was trying to strengthen commitment by having a referendum. Mm-hmm. And when the European leaders squashed that effort, they really were setting back the democratization process, because it was saying, we don't trust an agenda, mm-hmm. a referendum. And I think that was really a step backward. Maybe George wants to...
I agree, obviously, on that point. The referendum was, as you said, it would have created one thing which we need, more awareness of the types of issues we're dealing with, but a sense of ownership of this. And I think had we had that referendum, first of all, I think we would have won it. But not only that, it would have been a very strong mandate inside Greece for making the reforms more quickly, and without two elections and basically a lost year, which has cost the Greek citizens dearly, but also has created more mistrust around in Europe. But secondly, it would have been a sign to the world, first of all, to our partners and those who we appreciate have been funding Greece or lending Greece over the last 2 years. It would have been a very clear sign that we will both stay inside the Eurozone, the common currency, and we will be committed to the making the major changes. And I think that would have been a very positive sign all around. I really do believe that, as I said this earlier, that Europe, if it is going to survive, we have to see how it becomes a people's project and empowering our people. There are other ways too. I've talked about the Erasmus program. Just think, if you could get a scholarship, if an unemployed person, a young person, not only necessarily young, but because that's where the high unemployment is, could get a scholarship, and which would be from the European Union, would say, with this scholarship, you can choose an area of vocational training for retraining during this crisis. I think that would immediately, these types of things would immediately bring Europe much closer to our citizens.
Very good. Hi, I'm Alvaro Guzman. I'm a journalism student, and well, it's great to have you all here. We've been talking a lot about political decisions, and I'm mainly interested, and it's also great to have Mr. Soros here because he is more than a political economist or an economist. He was in the finance sector before, or still is. And you wrote a book in 1992 about after your drive, speculative drive against the pound, about how what you did back then, how you did it, and why it shouldn't happen again. And I think we forget where to start with this crisis started, and who are the only people benefiting from it, while Europeans suffer. We've mentioned many of the sacrifices we're being forced to do. I'm a European myself. So if you were to write a similar book again 22 years later, could you tell us what are we supposed to do to avoid that from happening? And what are we waiting to do to start it? Because also I think it's important to ask this question at this forum, because this university, I just got here. I'm proud to be a student here, but I'm proud of being a student here, but I see a really puzzling phenomenon, which is the two very important schools, the two schools where this could be happening, which is the business and the economic school, funneling talent and determination and talent in general to big investment banks, to that industry which has created this. Is it really, do all those people really need to be wanting to work for Goldman Sachs?
There's a simple question for you.
I didn't fully understand the question. I think that there are some really unresolved problems with the financial system, whether you know. In its current state, whether it is making a positive or not contribution to our welfare or not. Obviously, we need financial services, but whether they should absorb 30% of all the profits generated in the United States and Great Britain, as they did until the crisis, that's a very open question. We haven't yet really done enough thinking to fully restructure it. The problems are particularly deep in Europe. So I don't have the answer, but I'm looking for it.
Very good.
Thank you. Right. Good afternoon. My name is Nicholas Zaharia, student at SIPA. And I wanted to go back a little bit to the issue of the people's views and voice and considering the frustrated referendum in Greece. So in this context of austerity and in this context in which any political decision will take time to take place, time and resources at an European level, I'm thinking, trying to put myself in the shoes of the average citizen or the youth, the unemployed youth in Europe, and I ask you, aren't we to expect citizens' awakening in terms of opposing in terms of being pessimistic and opposing any further reforms, rather than an awakening of the bureaucrats and the political elite in Europe to try to bring a new stage into this setting?
Who would like to take a stab at that?
Well, I was talking about reawakening the spirit that fired people's imagination and to which we are still remain committed. And that means, I think, to be pro-European, but I think it also means being anti-establishment, because I think the establishment has actually failed the European ideal. And it happened after the financial crisis, when there was a feeling that the political will to make further progress towards political union has disappeared. And then the European establishment became very defensive, wanted to save the achievements, did not want to, for instance, renegotiate a treaty because they were afraid that the treaty would be defeated. And they had reason to believe it because, they, in fact, they were defeated whenever they were, it came to a... So that confined them into a conservative position. And they tried very hard to deal with the issues. But they had to do it within an existing framework, which we now acknowledge was very flawed. So you had to, instead of having a restructuring that was needed, you had a subterfuge, find some legal way around to make things hang together. And that is what is now happening, and this is why, unfortunately, we are in this process of disintegration where the public is generally disenchanted with the establishment. And you do need something more radical to reawaken that the upward momentum.
Yeah, I would just add to it that my view is that this can have very positive effect, but it can also give rise to extremist movements and parties and so on, as we see in some parts of Europe already. So one could observe both, and the question is which way it's going to be channeled.
Can I just say a word on that? I'm, first of all, on awakening bureaucrats, I mean, I have nothing against bureaucrats, but they're not trained, or at least we leaders don't train our bureaucrats in the right way necessarily to be the ones to point out always the opposite or the other side, which we should. But usually they're there to execute certain orders. So I wouldn't expect that Europe, the bureaucracy in Europe, is going to just all of a sudden awaken. The pressures are going to be those that will change, and that we already have pressures. But I would, I was asked by some of my students, well, what would you do if you were at our age? And I would say, well, when I remember when we were organizing, these were in the 70s, 60s, 70s, why not grassroots movements in Europe for a different Europe? But as Jan said, of course, not simply looking for scapegoats, which you have some extreme neo-Nazi like groups in Greece. That's not a protest for me. That's simply looking for ways to avoid responsibility, and certainly not simply protest, but let's find creative ways of bringing in proposals, crowdsourcing, if you like, using the internet to come and show pressure for new ways, a different Europe, a different vision of a Europe, and bottom up. And I would really like to see that kind of a movement developing. And as very much I would agree with George Soros being anti-establishment in that sense.
Let's see. I don't want to become highly unpopular with the audience. And let me say, I marched in lots and lots of student demonstrations in my day. But I used a word in my initial remarks about grown-up problems, grown-up solutions. And I'm not. This is not an age thing. Young people can be much more grown-up in their attitudes than some older people. But it's really respecting your electorate and not patronizing them, not giving them too simple solutions, not pretending that there are simple answers to complex questions, not scapegoating Europe. I mean, we in Ireland, we have a long tradition of referenda, and we've had a referendum for practically every European Union treaty change. And there have been, in the face of the austerity measures in Ireland, yes, there have been street demonstrations and so on, but not on the scale that we have seen in other countries, even though the pain inflicted for almost everybody in Ireland has been very severe. But there has been an enormous attempt to consult, to talk, to explain, to set out the choices, which are almost all difficult choices, and engage people in designing the responses with you. And even today, for example, the government just finished a negotiation with our trade unions, our public service trade unions, about further deep cuts in public sector pay, after we've absorbed already a number of rounds of cuts. And now the union leadership is ready to, as I understand, this is just news off the press, so I hope I've got it right, but will recommend this to its membership. There will be a ballot of the membership. So you will get that kind of buy-in to the cuts that the government deems as necessary. So I think, without saying, as I say, that being grown up is a prerogative of any particular age group, that search for and respect for the maturity of your electorate is absolutely key to finding our way through this without riots and without the kind of street behavior that none of us wants.
We have time for one more question in the formal setting here, but you're all invited to continue informally during a reception afterwards. So let's go for the last
formal. Good afternoon, I'm Tommaso, a student at business school. I was surprised no one of you talk explicitly about the idea of democracy, which implies the idea of the welfare state in Europe. Someone defined it as the paradox of the Diet Coke. People once ride, but they don't want to pay for it anymore in Europe. So, in your opinion, all of you, if and to what extent Europe should change this great achievement of the welfare state in the new century?
Okay. Two points. I mean, on the democracy part, remember, the elections for the European Parliament next year, I think, are going to be a great opportunity. If those elections can really dynamize the political process, I think a lot of these things should be debated during these elections. But for that, one needs an election space that's European. One needs a candidate that, for example, the European Socialist Party parties will present as their candidate to succeed Barroso as head of the Commission. One has to create that excitement. And I repeat, one thing the European Parliament could and should do to create the beginning of this excitement is to say no to the budget. It's the European Union's budget. This is the European Parliament. The majority has already said it doesn't agree. Let them vote no. And I think that will send a message. Now, in terms of I'm sure everybody has a view, but in terms of the European welfare and solidarity mechanisms, I think there's a big debate that's needed. I think the Nordic countries have done particularly well and are showing that you can have a very generous solidarity system, although with some flexibilities in it, and at the same time do economically quite well. So some kind of blanket, you know, statements that the European model doesn't work, I think these statements are quite wrong, factually. On the other hand, I think there are needs for adjustments. I'm on the center-left politically, but I don't think you can have the same retirement system in an age where life expectancy is 90, you know, than you had when the life expectancy was 65. Obviously, some adjustments are needed, but the fundamental idea that both there is need not only for regulation but also for solidarity, I think, is extremely important. And one of the issues here is flexibility in work sharing. Germany has done some interesting things during the crisis. I think expanding individual choice, letting people work flexible hours as they get older. There are many things one can do within an overall system of solidarity that improve also the efficiency of the system. And finally, even in Europe, not as much as in the US, the wealthiest are increasing their share. It's not quite like 90% of the gains, whatever gains there are over the next 10 years, goes to 1%, which is the case in the US. But even in Europe, particularly over the last few years, the wealthy have done much less badly than the vulnerable. So I think a tax system which which makes sure that everybody does pay their taxes, that Google doesn't pay everything but 6%, and this has to do with Ireland, of its corporate profit tax in Ireland. You know, the fact that Ireland has such a low corporate tax rate, I think, is a problem. And you know, if you're talking about Eurozone cooperation, at the end of the day, tax rates have to get closer to one another, and you have to avoid the race to locate yourself in the lowest tax country. So these things can work, but I think they have to be debated in political space at a European level. And the place to do that, of course, are the national parliaments, but also the European Parliament.
Okay, I hate to be the bad guy when the discussion is so good, but with the vision of us living until 90 and you until 120, let me thank everybody and let's move on to the reception.
That was really good.